and we have a few things to take a look at tonight in the lighting one, in the latter weeks of lighting one and in lighting two. We discuss gripology, or the way I like to think about it, the other half of the lighting department on a major feature film, for instance. Of course, on a regular feature film or a television show, for that matter, you've got a lighting crew, and that consists of a gaffer and that gaffer's assistant, which is frequently referred to as an assistant chief lighting technician, or the slang term for that position and that individual is a best boy. And then, of course, you have special operators. Those are folks like dimmer board operators, special equipment technicians, gang bosses who can take splinter units off in either direction and go light something in advance of the shooting crew. And then we have your third electrician, who is generally, we call him the pocket guy. He's with the gaffer on set, and he is working the lighting for what's being recorded into camera during principal photography on a normal shoot day. And that third electrician is supported by additional electricians on the roster. You may have extra people if you have night exteriors, for instance, or extra equipment, and you've brought in help or some kind of complicated location work that you have to do, and you've brought in extra individuals to help with the work with the workload. So you've got a lighting crew, and then working alongside the lighting crew are the grips. And the grips are interesting because they have to be jacks of all trades. They are doing things for the camera department, like moving cameras, moving tripods, moving dollies and track, moving cranes, jib arms. And then they're also working alongside the electric crew when we're trying to light. They do things for us like, they might put diffusion overall in front of something hard that we're projecting onto a background or onto an actor's face. They'll give us a diffusion frame maybe, or they'll give us a cider or a bottomer or a topper to block light off of things that we don't want the light to hit. So, we come in with the lighting units, and hopefully we can direct the output of those instruments to where we need to do our lighting. But more often than not, there's a little more there than what we really need, either on the subject or on the background. So the grips will come in and they'll start cutting stuff off and making sure that we've got only what we need hitting what needs to be hit. So these guys are really doing double duty, and it's a good opportunity to recognize participation and what the grip department has to offer. Because they often go unnoticed, unrecognized. However, everybody seems to know the term grip and refers mostly to lighting guys as grips, and then of course the grips get upset. So in recognition of them and their contributions, I just wanted to talk for a little while about some of the stuff that these guys are using to help us implement our lighting. Now I'm going to show you some small stuff. And the reason for that is because I want to show you some things that you may have access to now that won't be real expensive. You can add these things to your lighting kit and start increasing the number of options you have for yourself, or the number of ways that you can put lights up on your set. Mounting solutions for taking your light and mounting it to things like tree branches, fence posts, the top of doors, the sides of light stands, the edges of tables, the tops of bookcases, on banisters, on railings, on rooftops, just about anywhere you can think of where if that's the angle and what you got to work with over there is a tree branch or something, and you need your light to be 10, 12 feet up in the air, there's going to be a clamp for that, believe it or not. We got lots of them. So I wanted to show you a few of them tonight. Now, you might want to jot this stuff down, just these couple of things. There's some websites that you can go to where you can see more of this stuff that I'm going to show you. You can check out prices, pictures. Sometimes they have little mock-ups, photographs of rigs that they've done to show you how these tools function. And one of those websites is filmtools.com. Now, filmtools.com started off as an expendable supply store in Los Angeles on Magnolia Drive in the San Fernando Valley in Burbank. And for many years, they were there, and they sold gel and tape and foil black wrap and expendables, we call them, supplies that we use up on a regular basis on a film shoot. And then they expanded into actual gear. They started carrying lighting equipment and grip equipment, and now they've got cameras and lenses and filters, and they've got everything. You can go to their website, filmtools.com. And you can look at the different categories of products that they have to sell. They, you know, there's going to be a navigation bar at the top of the screen, cameras, lights, grip, expendables, gels, you know. And wander around the website, take a look at it. It's a retail outlet. So once upon a time, they used to be one of the few places in Los Angeles where you could get a roll of gel on a Sunday. But unfortunately, they're not really keeping weekend hours anymore. I think they're open on Saturdays until 4. But they used to be open all weekend, and, you know, when Mole Richardson was closed or the supply, expendable supply shop at the rental house was closed on a Saturday, you know, you used to be able to go into Studio Depot and Mole, their expendable supply store, and buy a roll of gel or a bag of pegs or whatever you needed. It's harder to do that now because, you know, the industry's changing. But so filmtools.com, they're a really good resource, and they can also occasionally answer questions if they're not too busy. Another website you guys should be aware of, I think I just mentioned it actually, studiodepot.com. Now that is the Mole Richardson retail store, the expendable supply store is what they used to refer to it as. Nowadays they just call it Mole Town or Studio Depot. Some folks still call it the expendable supply store, but Mole Town or Studio Depot is generally, you know, the nomenclature now. They're open Monday through Friday until 6 p.m. West Coast time. So that's 9 p.m. East Coast time. Now that's handy. The folks that are on the East Coast now, we can still call Studio Depot and get somebody on the phone during what are their normal business hours, and for us might be after hours. And Modern Studio Equipment in North Hollywood. If you go to modernstudioequipment.com, you can see the business that Senno and Rina Musali started in the late 70s. Senno was a grip, and in that day and age, there was a lot of inconsistency in the types of grip equipment that was available that could be rented or purchased. And so Senno, having a machinist background, started designing his own clamps and accessories for lighting equipment and selling them out of a catalog. And of course, now they have, you know, many years later, they have a website, and you can go and their catalog is online. You can look up all of the different stuff that they have available by category, either by clamp or by pipe, soft goods, stands, bags, dolly equipment, dolly accessories, camera accessories, and so on. Modern Studio Equipment is an excellent source for a lot of custom kind of gear that you may not find just anywhere. Camera mounts, for instance. Lots of stuff that are the day-to-day mechanical tools that we rely on to get all the shots that we want in a sequence or in a film. And, you know, always a secondary consideration on the part of a lot of folks who, you know, don't have as much experience. They don't know quite how to acquire these things when they need them for their shoot. So I want to talk to you about them tonight. So I thought I would start and talk to you just about clamps. There's lots of different kind of clamps. Of course, no matter where you go, there's going to be one clamp that's universally used, the number one fastener in the motion picture business, hands down, gaff tape. This stuff does so much, all kinds of different things. It is very strong. It's cloth-based, so it's easy to find your torn end. It's easy to tear because it's cloth-based, and the fibers in it allow you to make straight tears, so you can create nice, even pieces of whatever. You gotta tape some gel to the light, or you gotta tape a microphone to a table, or whatever you're doing. Gaff tape, that's your number one clamp. Make sure you have enough of this available to you at all times. Now, the retail value on a full roll of gaff tape these days is approaching $20. It's a little expensive, so, you know, don't be crazy with it, but don't be without it, because this stuff is the bomb. Okay, you need gaff tape. The next most popular kind of clamp you're going to see on a film set isn't really a clamp at all. It's actually a clothespin. Some people like to be cute and call it a C-47, and they love to invoke the old legendary anecdote that it was bin C-47 at Universal or Warner Brothers that had a whole bunch of these in it. I don't know. I don't know if that rumor is true. I don't know if any of that is true. But folks like to call this a C-47. It's a clothespin. I have a tendency to refer to them as pegs. It's just how I was brought up. The guys that I worked with when I was young and impressionable, we're calling them pegs now. I call them pegs. As long as we're using the terms that are, you know, fairly close and we know what we're all talking about. If we get our verbiage, you know, synchronized at the beginning of a shoot, you know, if I ask you for a peg, I want one of these, you know, a bag of pegs, you got a bag of pegs. C-47 just seems like too much stuff to come out of my mouth when I'm trying to talk about lighting on set and I got camera people and other people buzzing around me. Peg seems to roll off my tongue pretty quickly. So that's it. You can attach gels to lights and barn doors with them. You can clip, you know, microphones to people's wardrobe, whatever. Mostly we use them to attach gels to barn doors for lights. Like these guys back here. So you can get these in a bag of like 30 at Kmart or Walmart for a couple bucks. If you go to a place like Film Tools, you're going to pay probably $4 a bag for these because they're now number one spring-loaded media clamps and they have a higher value, but you can get them at the dollar store occasionally. It's just a little oak, little wooden oak clamp, and they're great. They are wood, though, so they will burn if you put them on a really hot light, and they're on there for a really long time. But if we're talking about LEDs or fluorescents or, you know, the variety of, you know, day-to-day stuff that we're handling, these are great. Okay, the next most popular clamp that you'll probably see a lot of is called a spring clamp. The clamp company Pony, like My Little Pony, Pony, P-O-N-Y, makes a variety of clamping accessories for construction and carpentry and so forth. They make parallel clamps, bar clamps, and angle clamps for cabinet makers, door makers, so they can work with wood and clamp their parts together, glue and nail or dowel peg them together and hold them in place while they dry. We use them to hold things like black felt or duvetine over windows to block light out in our sets. We can use them. They'll hold things. You know, you can spring clip things together as long as you understand that, you know, whatever force it took to open the clamp, if you got that much loaded onto whatever you're clamping together, this might not be the best bite. You might want something that can close down a little firmer. But you can see the value in something like this when you've got to temporarily clamp some stuff together. Like I said, mostly we use these to clamp black fabrics like duvetyne or felt cloth or black tarps or visqueen, black visqueen over windows to do blackouts for interiors of locations when we want to, you know, do a night interior scene. You can get them at Home Depot. This one is the middle size. There's a one size smaller than this called a number one pony clamp, and it'll say number one pony clamp right in the metal. You can't see it here, but you can kind of see there's something engraved in there. This is a number two pony clamp, and there's a number three, which is, I guess this one will open to 2 inches. The number three will open to 3 inches. The number one opens to 1 inch. So voila, 1, 2, 3. Okay, but these are great. These are like $249, $299 from Home Depot. The small ones are like $1, $1.50. The number threes are like $3.99 or $4.99. And we usually have, you know, we'll make a little rope lanyard out of sash cord or mason line, or, you know, we used to use also dog leashes, large, extra large dog leashes, and just clip a bunch of these to it, and then you've got a little, you know, you've got a little lanyard full of these clamps, and they're really handy. You should keep them close by, not real expensive. You can get a, you know, a handful of these for only a few dollars. So between your spring clip and your pegs and your gaff tape, you've already got an arsenal of clamps that you can get at Kmart. You know, I bet you didn't think you could get motion picture equipment at Kmart, but you can. If you don't have gaff tape, you can use duct tape. The problem with duct tape is it's designed for duct work or the silver expandable air handling tubes that transport the air conditioning through your house, through the rafters in your house. And duct tape, D-U-C-T, is designed to tape the two pieces of expandable tubing together so the air doesn't escape. So it's really, really sticky, okay? It's obnoxiously silver, which is really reflective. And when you remove the duct tape from a surface that's not, you know, it's semi-permanent tape. So on duct work, it's going to stick really good and it's not going to really want to come off. But you could tape it to the wall, let's say, and tape some felt around a window, right, to block the light out of the room coming from outside. And if you use duct tape and then you remove the duct tape, you could pull paint off the wall. You can certainly pull wallpaper off the wall. And if none of those things happen, duct tape leaves a sticky residue behind from the adhesive when it comes off the backing, and it's a mess. Gaff tape doesn't do that. It has a different kind of traction adhesive on it so that it's a little better on paint. If you have to tape things with heavy holding power to painted surfaces like walls, there's a paper version of gaff tape which is ideally suited for taping things to painted surfaces because you can pull that black photo tape off, 2-inch black photo tape, the paper stuff, and it won't pull the paint off with it. If you can't get a hold of the 2-inch black paper tape, we call it, or photo black paper tape, it's based on painter's tape, the blue tape, blue stuff, I think they call it. If you go to Home Depot in the painting supply aisle and look for the blue stuff, you'll see the 1-inch wide and 2-inch wide blue paper tape, and that's for taping drop cloths to walls and floors. It's for making tape lines So when you, if you, when you're painting, if you want to leave a strip unpainted for whatever reason, and you pull the blue stuff off, there's a nice clean paint line. That's what photo black paper tape is based on. This is the gaff tape, the cloth based stuff. So either this or the black photo tape is a good way to go. Nice thing about the black photo tape as well is oftentimes if you got light leaking through a door crack or something, you got a light coming from another room and you can see, you know, some spill coming through the door jamb, you can go on the back side of that door and you can tape it with black photo black, and then you've made a gobo, a go between your light and your subject or your environment, and you block that little bit of spill coming through the door jamb. So you, like I said, the number one clamp in a film set is gaff tape. You're going to use it for a lot of stuff. All right, that covers the basics. That covers what you can get from Walmart, Kmart, Home Depot, Lowe's, Costco, right? Now we're going to move into the next kind of clamp that's pretty common, and we call them gator clamps. We call them... well, we call them gator clamps because I don't know what else you would call these things. And if you look online, you can go to, say, Amazon.com, right? And you can type in the search box photo clamp or camera, comma, photo, comma, clamp. And you're probably going to get something that looks like this. And this isn't a bad deal, this little clamp. You can get them for about anywhere from between $3.60 to $6. Okay? It's basically a spring-loaded clamp with a wide jaw, right? And, you know, it's going to have some holding power. It's quite a strong clamp, actually. You can see my hand kind of quaking when I pull it open. It'll open to an inch and a quarter, inch and a half, right? Effectively. And you can clamp stuff. It has a photo pin on top. These things are made in China, okay? They're mass-produced. They're easy to make, and so they're cheap. But at least what they're doing for us is they're putting a photo pin on here. Now, it's got a 1/4-20 thread on the top, which you might initially say, oh, I don't need that. It's, you know. But if you think about it, you got a 1/4-20 receiver on the bottom of your pocket camera. You got a 1/4-20 receiver on the bottom of your Zoom recorder or your Tascam recorder. You got a 1/4-20 thread hole on the bottom of your DSLR. See where I'm going with this? All right, it's not just for lights. You can also mount other things using this 1/4-20. But basically, it's got a 5/8 pin with a little recessed groove in there so you can lock a light down onto it, right? So you can take this puppy and you can clamp it on the top of a door, and then you've got a pin you can mount your light to, and you don't have to use a light stand, right? So if I was going to shoot and I needed a light behind me, let's say, and I could frame out the top of that door back there, and then I could go and I could mount a light to the top of the door, right, and just run the cable somewhere out of frame where you don't see it, there wouldn't be anything down, no, there's a bunch of stuff back there right now, but there wouldn't be a stand back there that you could see, the camera, and I could have the light on me doing a, you know, an edge light or something. Okay, so that's the idea. That's what we're doing here. That's what we're talking about, is clamping lights to stuff and not needing so many light stands. You know, if you're a one-man band and you're running from location to location and trying to do your lighting setups and stuff, sometimes clamps can be your best friend. You know, you can have a bag full of these and put a whole bunch of lights out and get yourself working really fast. You can clamp your cables up out of the frame and everything. Or you can grab a bag of stands and take those with you. And, you know, you'll know the difference right away between six of these in a bag and six light stands in a bag, right? What would you rather drag around with you? So this is the basic one, right? And I'm just going to give you a nice look at that for a minute, because there's a few variations of this guy that I want to show you next, okay? I took these guys, and since I didn't need, now I got a bag full of these with the thread. I got a bag full of these with no pin on them. And then I got a bag full of this guy. And what I did is I put a special pin on there. It's 5/8 recessed, but there's no 1/4-20 spud on the top. It's just flat and smooth, right? So this is strictly for lights. That's it. Doesn't do anything camera because there's no screwing and threading going on. This will just hold a light. And I don't have to worry about, you know, people getting knuckled and, you know, you're trying to put a light up and stuff and you're, you know. But, you know, for clamping recorders and camera bits and stuff, you know, you want a few of these with the thread on them. Okay, so that's the two standard variations. Now you got this guy. Check him out. Not only does he have a pin coming off the side now, but this one has a 5/8 receiver, so it goes on the stand like that and clamps off at a different angle, right? You can put this on a light stand, and then you can clamp something to this, a bounce maybe. You know, I don't know what you're going to be clamping, but, you know, on top of a light stand and start doing reflector work. It also has a little ball head on top, so you can use this for a, like a, you know, an LED light, you know, on-camera light that you need to, you know, clamp somewhere, right? And then all of a sudden, you know, now you can clamp this onto, you know, top of the door, you know, whatever. And these will be a little bit more expensive. So if the bottom clamp is like anywhere from $3.50 to say $6-$7, this guy is probably going to be something like $9 or $10. And go to Amazon.com and again, clamp, camera, photo. And this is going to pop up in one of the searches, and you should see dozens of dealers selling these for anywhere from $8.99 to $12.99. Okay. And they're pretty handy. And if you, you know, if you get these for the two different ways to mount lights and just take the ball heads off, you'll end up with a little bag full of ball heads too, if you, you know, if you want to go that route. Okay. Spring clips keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay. So we can start getting into the big daddies like this guy. Okay. And I've had this guy a long time. It's pretty scarred up, but hey, you use them a lot for a lot of stuff. Look at the giant gripper pads in there. Those teeth. That's where the nickname Gator Clamp comes from. You see that? Looks like an alligator mouth. Okay, you got your light spud up here, your 5/8 pin for your lights. And this will grab bigger stuff, right? This will grab a 2x4 in that jaw right there, because that's 2x4 inches. So you can, you know, the beams in a garage, you know, if you're working on a construction site and you're, you know, they're building a building and they haven't, you know, sheetrocked it or side, you know, put the siding on yet, you can grab 2x4s, whatever, you know, what are you going to be grabbing? I don't know, but here it is. This is a full-size gator grip, and there's one bigger than that, and we call it a sky hook. Where is that guy? Here he is. This is called a sky hook, okay? It's got 5/8 in a couple of places, right? It's got this giant jaw. It's a 3-inch gap in the back, and when you open this bad boy up, you can see the potential for grabbing that this guy has. And this is, you know, this takes some muscles to use, because it's a pretty tough clamp. It's got a lot of bite, a lot of powerful bite, and you can adjust, you know, how wide the jaw opens by turning this screw, right? And you turn that screw and you can, you see how it's getting narrower? I can make it, you know, as small of a bite as the last gated clamp I had in my hand, if that's all I needed to bite, right? And the narrower you make this, the stronger the bite is. So that's the difference between having one of those and one of these. This one does only the one kind of bite. This one will do several more depending on how you have it adjusted, and the narrower you make it, the stronger it is. And so, you know, you might trust this. If you had to clamp vertically and then hang a light off it, you might trust this more to not slip off what you've mounted it to than even this guy, which is a pretty strong clamp. Okay, so the Skyhook, these are about $50 on Amazon. You can also buy them through Film Tools. I don't think Modern carries Skyhooks. They might be able to order them for you, and they'd get them from China. You can order them on Amazon. You can order them on Alibaba. And you can order them off of eBay. So Google Skyhook, comma, photo clamp, comma, camera, all of those search topics to get yourself to this clamp right here. About $49-$50 online. Okay, I think that covers spring clamps. Okay, now there's a few other kinds of clamps. Okay, you may have seen, if you got a dad who works with wood or does projects in the garage, you may have seen a clamp like this before. It's called a bar clamp or a furniture clamp, and it was for gluing several pieces of lumber edge to edge, gluing them along the bead, and several of these over, say, you know, 3 or 4 feet would allow you to start assembling a tabletop out of 6-inch, 8-inch, or 10-inch strips of pine or fir or whatever, walnut, oak, whatever you were making your tabletop out of. Woodworkers are using this tool, but we also use it to clamp anything that's this wide. Okay, so let's say you're working in a warehouse and there's a big old I-beam over your head and you want to clamp something to it. Well, you can bring a C-clamp in that'll bite something this wide, but a C-clamp this big, probably going to weigh 10 pounds. This guy isn't that heavy. It's adjustable, and then you do the fine adjustment and tightening with the threaded handle. Okay, now that's the clamp portion. If you go to Modern Studio Equipment online, you get the other half of the equation, which is this guy right here, okay? And this is the pin part of the formula that you need to hang your light. So you got your furniture clamp, then you see that little cross hole? Boom, right on the end of this rod bracket. You lock it down with the lockdown knob, and now you got a furniture clamp with a 5/8 baby pin on there. You can mount your light to that. You can mount it the other way, right? You can slide it all along the bar. So once you get this thing up and locked in, this guy can slide up and down the length, or it can go the other way, right? And you've got your place to mount your light right there, right? That's it. That's the furniture clamp. We call it a Fernie clamp for short. If you look in, say, for instance, the UVA grip book, which I have right here, he's going to call it a Fernie clamp, right? Furniture clamp, Fernie clamp. Okay. That's it. That's what it looks like. Okay. These are really handy. They come in a 6-inch variety that's only like that long. This is a 14-inch variety. They got 24-inch. They've got 10-inch, 8-inch, okay? You can get these online fairly inexpensively, but you know what? Home Depot sells them too. Ace Hardware, they're just as cheap. Big Lots sells a lot of these. Cheap, like $3, $2, $2.50. You can get these. This is going to cost you more from Modern. This pin here probably cost you $15. But 15 and, say, 5. Let's say $5. $20, you can do the whole deal, right? And this will bite a lot of stuff because this jaw will open out to 14 inches wide. Okay? Not a bad deal. It's a furniture clamp. Now, if you use a lot of beadboard reflectors, the styrofoam reflectors, also from modern studio equipment, is what we call a quacker or a platypus, I think they call them, a duck bill, some of the guys call them. I call it a beadboard holder because it holds beadboard, right? Beadboard reflectors. We use those by the ton on movies. All it is a 1-inch thick by 4x8 sheet of styrofoam board. It's actually insulation for houses. When they're building the house and they frame it all out with your 2x4s and studs, they go over the top of that first with beadboard. It's an insulator. It's a vapor barrier, right? And then over the top of that, they'll put plywood if it's a good builder. If not, they don't put any plywood. And then they'll go over that with the siding on the outside of your house. So, but we use it because it's white, it's highly reflective. We cut it in 4x4 pieces, 4x8 pieces, 2x2 pieces, 1x2 pieces, 2x4 foot pieces, all different shapes and sizes. The 2x2 foot piece, we call a pizza box because it's about the size of a pizza box and almost as thick. And it's a reflector. A sheet of this stuff is like $13 from Home Depot. If you cut it up into one 4x4 and two 2x2s and one 2x4 reflector, you just made four reflector boards. You can use them for your entire shoot. When you're done, throw it away, right? Because the stuff gets all pilly and dirty and nasty. We want it when it's brand new and pristine because it reflects really well. Really good bounce, diffused look you get from using beadboard with a light. When you bounce the light off of it, it looks beautiful. You can use beadboard outside during day exteriors and just catch the sun with your reflector. Perfect. If you can get the stuff that has the silver foil on one side and the white bead on the other, even better, because now you get a silver side. We call that a hard side. Hard silver reflection on one side, white soft diffused reflection on the other side. Man, you can't beat the stuff. This clamp grabs the beadboard, and then it has a pin, and that's going to allow you to mount the beadboard to something like a C-stand, which is this right here. You got the 5/8 hole. Open it up. The C-stand holds that. You put your reflector board inside. Boom. It's holding it for you. You're bouncing your light into it. You're lighting, right? Platypus, beadboard holder, duckbill, foam core holder, whatever you want to call it. Modern's got them. These are like $35-40 from Modern. Kind of expensive, but you get a couple of those in your package. Once you start acquiring things like C-stands, you'll use these more than you will without, because if all you have are your kit stands or your light stands, you won't be able to use it until you get some gobo heads. So let me show you some of those. Here's a traditional gobo head, okay? It's called a 2.5-inch gobo head because that's the dimension of the gripper part right here. And you'll see it's got several different sizes of holes. This one is for your light stand, right? If I take the gobo arm and head off of this guy, lay it down there, and just, okay, here's a 5/8 pin, right? So let's say this is your light stand, right? It's not a C-stand, it's your light stand. Okay, so you take your gobo head, right there, right? Lock it down. Right, so it's on top of your stand. Now, you've got three different size holes. You got a 5/8 hole or 5/8 receiver. It's a little smaller than that, so when you bite down, it'll hold. 5/8. This is 1/8 inch for like a very small, we call them dots and fingers, little teeny tiny cutting and diffusing devices for like tabletop work and stuff. You got a quarter inch hole, okay? That's for small nets and flags. And then you got a 3/8 inch hole, And some of them have a half-inch hole as well. Now you're going, what are all the holes for? Well, the 5/8 hole is for holding something with a 5/8 pin on it. Okay? Boom. Look at that. Right? Right? See how easy that is? Just lock that guy in there like that. You guys know lefty, loosey, righty, tighty. Okay. If I turn this knob to the right, I tighten it down. If I turn it to the left, I loosen it up. So when I lock something in here, I generally want the weight to be falling off the right side of this head so that as it's wanting to fall this way with its own weight, it's actually tightening itself up in the process as well so that it can't come loose. All right. But that's what a gobo head does. Now, that's a 2.5-inch gobo head, right? It's made out of cast aluminum. So something like this is costing you on Amazon or at Film Tools. I think you can get them for $25.99, $29.99. But there's other sizes. You can get these guys for like $15, I think, from Film Tools. This guy's plastic, right? So it's lighter. And it's not, it's like a 2-inch. It's not a 2.5. It's smaller than this guy. You see? This is made by Matthews Studio Equipment, MSE, Matthews Studio Equipment. It only has the 3/8 hole. And you're going to go, but dude, I got 5/8. Well, it's got the 5/8 over here for your stand, right? And then the 3/8... it's for this other cool thing I'm going to show you. So let's put this on here like that. Let's get him locked on. All right, there's our little plastic 2-inch gobo head. And we talked a lot about flagging and cutting your light off of things that you don't want to get illuminated on set. You've got these big soft boxes, right? And they spill light everywhere. So sometimes you're going to be lighting with that, but you're not going to want the light to hit a certain wall or the floor, or, you know, you want to do a topper on it so that, you know, let's say the top of the set wall and the top of your characters have a little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a fade on them, you know, like so. Before you start getting into the big grip gear and the nets and flags and all that cumbersome stuff that usually needs a truck and several guys to help you with, they got little kits like this called road rags, okay? And these are great. There's actually three 18 by 24 frames in here that break down like tent poles, and they go into this nice sleeve. So you can open this thing up, and you've got a silk diffuser. You've got what's, we call this a single net, okay, which is a half-stop reduction in your light output. There's a double net over here, which is a full-stop reduction of output from your light. 18 by 24 inch, it's a net material. It's called bobbin net. It doesn't diffuse the light in any way. It doesn't soften it up and make it low contrast. All it does is reduce the output proportionally. One stop is red, a half stop is green. And then there's a solid, which I've already got rigged up in a frame. The frames are in the long pocket over here. You can't see them. Not much to see anyway. Well, maybe I can show you. Let's see. It looks like a tent pole. It comes broken down like so, right? Look at this. That's the 3/8 pin that goes in here. Okay? Here's your 3/8 pin. So what we're going to do is, with the bungee cord that's inside, we're going to find the slots for this frame to kind of mount like that. And it's getting kind of big for the camera, but it does that, right? And then you pull the ends together and you stretch those nets fabrics or diffusion fabrics on this frame, and then this frame mounts in your gobo head. right? And you can hold your material in there, and you can cut your lighting accordingly. And you can do that with your regular light stands, because these aren't very heavy. So when you put the solid fabric in, you get a guy like this, right? And if I just take this back out real quick, and I put the solid in there, right? Now, I've got a tool I can work with. I can orient it up and down, over to the side, swing it in and out, right? Side off my lighting, top my lighting, bottomer, whatever. Boom, boom, just like that, right? It can also work with your gobo head on your light stand. And the whole thing might get a little top heavy because your kit stands are pretty lightweight. You got to put some ballast on the base of the stand to keep it from toppling over. But then you can be using these cutters, Matthews Road Rags. You can go to B&H Photo, bhphoto.com out of New York City. They're a wholesale photographic equipment vendor. And they sell their house version of stuff. They'll sell you the Matthews Road Rags if you want the Matthews brand, the MSE brand, Matthews Studio Equipment. They also have their own house brand of grip equipment, stands, and certain things. And they have a road rag kit as well under their house name. And it escapes me right now what that name is. But if you go to the B&H website and look and in the search box, just type in, you know, grip gear. Boom, it'll show you everything they got that they carry that's grip related. And then just look for the road rags, the Matthews road rags. And if you select those, it'll offer you their house brand at a reduced price. And then you'll see exactly what that is. These come in 18 by 24 and 24 by 36. Okay, so a 2 by 3 flag or an 18 inch by 24 inch flag. Okay, and you can start doing grip cuts, grip diffusion, and grip netting with a road rags kit. The Matthews kit is a little pricey. It's like $300. Okay, the house brand from B&H is a lot cheaper. It's more than half that, or less than half that, I should say. Like $120, I think, for theirs. And Westcott, the light modifier company, Westcott, also available through B&H, also has a collapsible road rags kit. And they're going to be priced in between the two, in between B&H's. Impact is the name of the B&H house brand. Impact. Impact collapsible 18 by 24 flag kit, bhphoto.com. Google it, and it'll be like $100, and you get all the parts, and you can start doing some grip cutting on your light. Okay. Talked about tape, talked about clamps, talked about gator clamps, talked about gobo heads. I've been flashing this thing around for a few minutes now, and I haven't really talked to you about it at all. This is artboard, poster board. You guys in high school and in grade school, in primary school, you were doing your finger paints on this and you were taping your sketches or your photographs or your arty things, gluing it to this stuff, turning it in as your homework. Well, now you need to go buy this stuff because it's also a reflector. You got to get it when it's new and it's white. You see what it's doing to my low side? Bam, bam, bam. This stuff, you get them in packages like this, okay, from the art supply store, from Walmart, from Home Depot, from Office Depot, Staples, Office Max, this whole Michael's art supply store, this whole box, there's six of these in it was like $5, right? This is 8.5 by 11. It's the size of a piece of typing paper. It's also a really great reflector. I mean, look how good of a job that does. It's off camera, and it's still popping me pretty good on the low side. If I needed a little extra fill right there, which I don't, but if I did, boom, 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 right? It's hard rolled paper on top and on bottom, and in between is foam. It's quarter of an inch thick. That's why we call it foam core. Okay, foam core. It's got paper on the top, paper on the bottom, and styrofoam in between. It's a quarter of an inch thick, and it's an awesome reflector. You can get this in 24 by 36 inch sheets, right? You can cut whatever size out of it you want. You can cut shapes into it, circles, squares, stars, whatever. You can bounce light off of it. You can see how bloomy it is in the camera. Boom, that's my key light bouncing off the wall, and I'm catching a little bit of that, tossing it right back at you. Boom, this is great reflector material. You can cut it with a knife, make it into any shape you want. I like these little guys for close-up work because they're really handy and you can get them into tight spaces. All right, so that's bounces. We talked about beadboard. We talked about gator board. What have I got left for you? I know what I have left for you. The last thing I wanted to talk to you about tonight, and then I'm going to call it a night, is a flex fill. Okay, you've probably seen these a million times. I got a bunch of them. The best kind to get is the 5-in-1 reflector because it has 5 surfaces that you can use to bounce with. It'll have a gold surface, silver surface, a black surface, a white reflective surface, and then a white shoot through, which is the base material on the base frame. And then you'll have a slip cover that goes over the top of that that'll be, you know, 2 different colors on either side of the disc. So silver on one side, black on the other. You take the slip cover, turn it inside out. You'll have white on one side and gold on the other. Okay. This one is silver only, but I just wanted to show it to you because this one's only like, I think this is a 20-inch reflector, but it collapses down into a little 8-inch bag. And I carry this around in my knapsack all the time when I go out places. I throw a small camera in one of these in my knapsack, you know, with my lunch or whatever, and I'm going off and I'm doing something, biking or hiking or, you know, whatever, I don't know. And you got a little light source. This one happens to be black on silver. So it's kind of springy when you open it up, okay? But boom, look at that. And that's pretty intense. Silver, you can see how reflecty it is. Look at, bam, bam. And it's white on the other side. Just like the foam core and the beadboard, it's white fabric. And these bounce awesome. Boom, boom. That's the white side. If I go to the silver side, pow, look at that. I'm knocking my ear things out. But bam, bam. Look how hard that is. You can almost get an edge light out of this if you have sunlight, for instance, and you use this bad boy outside. Man, this with some sun, natural sunlight and another white beadboard reflector on the fill side, use the sun as a backlight, catch this, give yourself a look at the edge it's giving me right there. That's pretty cool. These are great. You don't have to plug them in. You don't have to do anything. When you're done with them, alternate your hands and fold it back up. Put it in the sleeve, throw it back in your knapsack, pull out your sandwich, have lunch, do whatever you got to do, and your light kit just went back in this little tiny sleeve, okay? It's got a little, you know, tag loop so you can hang it on stuff. The reflector itself also has one of these. Guess what? Bam! Spring clip, one of these, clip it to a branch on a tree in the right bounce angle. You got a helper that's holding your light for you while you're out shooting your girlfriend or whatever, and you're clamping, you're lighting, you're doing it all outside, and nothing gets plugged in. So you can do this. None of this stuff is really expensive. We're talking, you know, $3, $4, $5 to $15, $20 to $50 for some of these clamps. Get them one at a time. You don't got to run out and buy a whole bin of this stuff, right? Just get what you're going to work with right now, and you build the package up slowly. You get a few bucks, you buy another clamp, toss it in your kit, and you build it over time, right? You don't have to go out and do this all right away. But before you know it, if you keep at it, you've got a nice complement of gear that you can use on your shoots, okay? One last clamp. Let me show you this right here. This was the workhorse of the industry, okay? This is called a Mafer clamp. I don't know where they got Mafer from. But basically, you can see it's a jaw, right? It's got an angular side. That's for biting a 2x4. And then it's got this adjustable side. And you can close it down to where it'll bite something really small and kind of squarish. Or you can crank it out way wide. And you can bite something that's really wide, like a piece of pipe or a railing or a tree branch or something. But you can develop a lot of biting strength with this T-handle. And this puppy, man, this will hold a lot of weight, right? It's got a 5/8 photo pin that goes in the bottom of it. You loosen this knob and you push this spring-loaded button here and the pin comes right out. And it's got a 3/8-16 thread on this side, which is a standard tripod thread, right? Maybe your gobo or your tripod head comes off your tripod, putting that on here. It's got a 1/4-20 thread on the other side, and then both ends of this is 5/8 for your light. And this pin just goes in that octagonal or hexagonal hole in the bottom there. And these are 1/4-20 threaded holes, by the way. You never know what you're going to do with that. But they're there, right? Gives you lots of mounting capability. And this is the receiver for the photo pin. You just put it in there, plunge it, pop it in, tighten it back down so it doesn't come out, right? There's for your light. There's for your bite. Mafer clamp. M-A-F-E-R. Mafer clamp. B&H photo video. BHphoto.com. Impact. Gaffer clamp, Mafer clamp, $26.95 with the pin. I know this. I've seen them on the website before. These are great. I have about 50 of these on my lighting truck. We use these a lot. This used to be the only clamp of its kind on the market. It's got this super strong jaw. Bites like crazy, and it'll hold 30, 40 pounds worth of equipment off that pin with just that amount of bite. Strong. Okay? But you're going to pay like 25, 26 bucks for it. Could be worth it. Then another company came along from Italy called Cardellini. Actually, I think the guy's name was Cardellini. I don't think he was from Italy at all. Maybe his grandfather was. But he developed a clamp that looks kind of like this. Okay? You see how his jaws are a little bit different? They're kind of wide, like the spring clamp. Yeah? Kind of the same shape, too, if you look at it. Kind of the same, reminds me of the same kind of clamp. But this guy right here bites like the Mafer clamp. You take the lockdown nut and you run it down on, this is threaded. Here's your 5/8 pin right here for your light. Your jaw opens up like that, and the wider you unscrew it, the wider the jaws are apart, right? You can bite a railing or a round piece of pipe. The grips use stuff called speed rail, aluminum 1¼ or 1½ diameter pipe for their car rigs and stuff. Boom! You can mount the pipe with one of these, put your light on it, you're lighting, right? This is a Cardellini. These are about $50 a piece. They're kind of expensive. But this is what the big boys are using. Cardellinis and Mafer clamps. You can't beat them, right? So, you know, maybe you have a couple of these in your kit or a couple of Mafer clamps maybe is a better value. And a bunch of these for cheap. A bunch of these. A bunch of pony clamps. A couple of these guys. You can buy these for like 20 bucks online. For the 24-inch 5-in-1 reflector. This is only silver and black, so this is like maybe 12 bucks, right? For all you got $12, get the silver and black one. You got 20, get the 5-in-1, you get the extra bounce surfaces. Go to Home Depot, get some spring clamps. Boom. It's not that hard to do.